Hello friends, welcome back in SS class. Today we are going to continue with the same lesson, lesson number 2, Kings and Kingdoms of Early Medieval Period. In the previous class, in the previous lesson, we had seen that in the 7th century, the regional kingdom rose and the Samantas, who were actually the warriors, they were not related to dynasty, but even though they started expanding or ruling over the kingdoms, and they also started increasing their kingdoms. Okay, and after that we had seen that Samantas, they gained power and gradually they became and they started carving out their kingdoms. After that we had seen about the Rashtrakutas. Rashtrakutas were subordinate to the Chalukyas. Subordinate mean lower in position, so they were subordinate to Chalukyas. Here in the mid 8th century, an important person whose name was Dantidurga declined or defeated Chalukyan overlord, and then he established his kingdom. Okay, after that we had seen that some of the other profession, some of the peoples of other profession also started carving out their kingdoms, started establishing their kingdoms. Some of them were Mayurashramas, and after that we had Gurjara Pratiharas, Harichandra. So here Mayurashrama and Harichandra, they were Brahmins by profession and by caste, even though they carved out their kingdoms. After then we had seen that these kingdoms, these regional kingdoms, were not as vast as of Mauryas and Guptas. Why? Because Mauryas and Guptas were actually continuously involved in the war. Okay, and after that we had seen the Rajputas, some of the important kingdom dynasties, and they were Rajputas, Gurjar Pratiharas, Palas, after that Rashtrakutas and Cholas. Okay, and after that we had seen about the Rajputas. The Rajput, this word derived from Sanskrit word Rajputra, and Rajputra means the son of Raja, the son of king. After that we had seen about Rajputra, the dynasties from Suryavanshi, Chandravanshi and Agnikul. Okay, after that it was believed that the Rajputras were Rajputs were from Central Asia, such as Sakash, Kushanas, Huns and Gujaras. Okay, up till that we had seen. After that we had seen that after the death of Harshvardhan, there was vast change in the rule of the kingdoms. The people or the kings were the kings started battling with each other to expand their empires. Why? Because there were certain reasons behind that: fertility of land, armies, weapons, or the wealth of particular kingdom. Okay, so up till this we had seen in our previous lesson or in our previous class. Now we are going to learn about the Pals and the Gurjar Pratiharas. Here, Pals, after Rajputs, there is the Pal dynasty. Okay, important and powerful dynasty. Now the Palas were the important and powerful dynasty in eastern India. Okay, where in eastern India they established the Pal kingdom was established by the Gopal, and it has been believed that Gopala was elected by the people. Now Gopal's son Dharampal helped him conquering the other kingdoms also. He conquered Kannauj. Okay, after that spread across the region of present-day Bihar and Bengal. Now this Pal kingdom, it was spreaded across the regions of present-day Bihar and Bengal. After that, Devpal expanded the boundaries. Now here we have Dharampal and Devpal. Dharampal was the son of Gopal, and here we have Devpal. Devpal was the grandson of Gopal. So Devpal expanded the boundaries to include Assam, Odisha and some part of Nepal. Here also Devpal also helped him in expanding the kingdom, and he conquered, or we can say he won Assam, Odisha and some part of Nepal, and he included them in their kingdom. Okay, after that, patrons of Buddhism. Here we have one word, patron. Patron means the person who gives financially help to other people. So here Buddhism. So the Pal dynasty was the patrons of Buddhism. So they were helping them financially or in any manner they could. So here they were the patrons of Buddhism. Now here Dharampal established a famous university, that is Vikramshila University. So here we have seen about the Pals. Now here we have Gurjar Pratihars. Here Gurjar Pratihars ruled over Western India and parts of Upper Gangetic Valley. Okay, so we can say that their kingdom was there in Western India and Upper Gangetic Valley. Now the founder Harichandra, here Gurjar Pratihars, this kingdom or this dynasty, who was the founder of this dynasty? So Harichandra was the founder of this dynasty and he expanded his kingdom. Rulers rose to power because they defended the northern boundaries from the invasion from 712 to 1000. Now here they expanded their kingdom, their dynasty to northern boundaries. How? When the invaders came to the northern boundaries, these Gurjar Pratiharas defended the boundaries and they defeated them, and also, and this way they included the northern boundaries to their kingdom. Gained prominence during the rule of Nagbhat I. Now here the Gurjar Pratihars gained prominence, or they came in importance, or they became famous during the rule of Nagbhat I. Why? Because Nagbhat I had conquered, he had won Malwa and Bharuj. Now Mihir Bhoja during 836 to 819. He was the most famous ruler of Gurjar Pratiharas. Whosoever rulers were there from Gurjar Pratiharas, Mihir Bhoja, one of the most ruler. He captured Kannauj. He won Kannauj and he made Kannauj his capital. Okay. Expanded his empire to parts of Punjab, Awadh, Malwa and Gujarat. After that he won these kingdoms. After that he won these regions and he expanded his kingdom. Now Mahendrapal was the son of Mihir Bhoja. Okay, so Mahendrapal helped his father in expanding his empire further by conquering Magadh and North Bengal. After that his son Mahendrapal, Mihir Bhoja's son Mahendrapal, won Magadh and Bengal and helped him in expanding his empire. Now the dynasty or the rule of the Gurjar Pratiharas declined in the 10th century. Okay, they were not more prominent. They lost their dynasty, they lost their kingdom in the 10th century when the invader Mahmud Ghazni invaded his kingdom. Okay, so here we can say that the Gurjar Pratiharas rule or the kingdom declined in the 10th century with the invasion of Mahmud Ghazni. Okay, so here we have seen about the Pals and the Gurjar Pratiharas. These are one of the famous dynasty during the early medieval period. Before this we had seen Rajputs also. So here we can make a note of important points, that the Palas here, who are the most important or who are the kings who ruled over the kingdom. So here we can see Gopal, okay, his son Dharampal and his grandson Devpal. Okay, so these are the three rulers of the Palas. Now here Gurjar Pratiharas. In Gurjar Pratiharas, who is the founder? Harichandra. Harichandra is the founder. And after that, who was that another one? Nagbhata I. Okay, after that we have Mihir Bhoja and his son Mahendrapal. So these were the rulers of Gurjar Pratiharas. Okay, Harichandra, Nagpatavan, Mihir Bhoja and Mahendrapal. Okay, now here we are going to learn about the Rashtrakutas. So who were the rulers during this dynasty of these dynasty during the early medieval period? Let's see. The Rashtrakutas. Here, the Rashtrakutas, as we had seen previously, that the Rashtrakutas were subordinate to Chalukyas, means lower in position. They were the Samantas of Chalukyas. They used to fight the war for Chalukyas. Now here, they became a powerful dynasty of the Deccan region. After that, Samantas of Chalukyas, as I said you, Danti Durga declared his independence after overthrowing his Chalukyan overlord. Now here, as I had said you, that the Rashtrakutas, this Danti Durga was important person of Rashtrakutas. He established the dynasty Rashtrakuta. So here, this Danti Durga, he declined the Chalukyas overlord, and then after that he declared his independence. After overthrowing the Chalukyas overlord, performed a ritual named Hiranyagarbha. Now here, what is the meaning of Hiranyagarbha? Here Hiranya means golden, okay, and here Garbha means warm or shade, we can say. So here Hiranya means golden and here Garbha means we can say warm or seed. Okay, now after, what is the real exact meaning of this Hiranyagarbha? Hiranyagarbha is golden worm. It is a ritual that is performed by a king who wished to be Kshatriya in his next birth. So here, whosoever performer is there who performs this ritual, he believes that it is supposed to lead to the rebirth of performers as a Kshatriya. Even when a king is not Kshatriya, in the medieval or early and in ancient time, whosoever person wins or conquers any kingdom, if that person does not belong to a Kshatriya, he has to perform some rituals to become Kshatriya, or the person who again wants to be Kshatriya in his next birth, he would perform this ritual. Okay, so even if he was not Kshatriya, he performed these rituals so that he, in his rebirth, he could be a Kshatriya. Now here we have some of the kings who were most important and famous kings who ruled over the kingdom. They were Govinda III. From 793 to 814. After that we have Amogha Varsha from 814 to 817. Then we have Krishna III. Krishna III from 934 to 963. So these all are well-known rulers of the Rashtrakut dynasty. Now in the north, they fought against, sorry guys, here the spelling is fought, F-A-U-G-H-T. They fought against Pals and Gurjar Pratiharas. In north, they became in the battle with Pals and Gurjar Pratiharas. Why? To get the control over Kannauj. Okay. In south, they became in territorial conflict with Pallavas of Kanchipuram. So here also they became in conflict with Pallavas. In north, they became in conflict with Pals and Gurjar Pratiharas. Okay, now they encouraged growth of Kannada. Okay, here the Rashtrakutas encouraged the growth of Kannada. Amogha Varsha was a poet himself. Okay, even though he was ruling over the kingdom, he was fond of writing poetry. So he was a poet and he wrote the poetry in Kannada. Now, the Kailashnath Temple at Ellora, the Elephant Cave near Mumbai were constructed by the Rashtrakutas. Now, these two things, Ellora, Kailash Temple of Ellora and Elephant Cave near Mumbai, they were constructed by the Rashtrakutas. So here, what should be the main points that you can remember easily? So here, Rashtrakutas. First, the founder, Dharti Durga. Okay. So here, Chalukyas, they were Samantas. Okay. And they declined or they defeated Chalukyas. After that, Danti Durga. Danti Durga was the founder of this Rashtrakuta dynasty. And after that, he performed Hiranyagarbha. Hiranyagarbha means golden worm. Then most famous rulers, Govinda, Amoghvarsha and Krishna. Okay. After that, the conflict between Pals, Gurjar Pratiharas and them in north with Pals and Gurjar Pratiharas. Now if we see in south, so they were in conflict between they were in conflict with Pallavas of Kanchipuram. Okay. After that, they encouraged growth of Kannada. Now here Amoghvarsha was a very famous Amoghvarsha was a poet. He wrote the poetry in Kannada. Then Kailash Temple and Elephant Caves, they were constructed by the Rashtrakutas. So here we have completed our another dynasty, that is the Rashtrakutas. After that, we are going to learn about the Tripurite struggle. Okay, in the Tripurite struggle, we will see the three kingdoms or the three dynasties in conflict to get the control over Kannauj. Okay guys, so let's see. So we have tripartite struggle. Now what is this tripartite struggle? Tripartite struggles means the struggle with three parties or the war in between among three parties. So here the Gurjar Pratiharas, the Palas and the Rashtrakutas, they wanted their control over Kannauj. So they all three dynasty, they had the conflict among them to get the control over Kannauj. So here the fight between the Palas, the Gurjar Pratiharas and the Rashtrakutas over the control of Kannauj referred to as the tripartite struggle. Okay. Now, because it involved, this struggle involved three parties, that is why it is called tripartite struggle. Now these three parties wanted to get control over Kannauj. Kannauj was situated, it is located in North India in Upper Gangetic Valley. Every dynasty would like to have get control over this. Why? Because if they get control over it, they can get the rich natural resources and fertile land of the Ganga. Because at that time Kannauj city was the supremacy. After kingdom of Harshvardhana, this city was a symbol of supremacy. So these three parties wanted to get control over Kannauj. So here, that is why it is called the tripartite struggle. And during this struggle, actually the struggle continued for 2 centuries. So because of that only, these three dynasties or these three kingdoms weakened, okay, and they lose control over their rule. So here we have completed our tripartite struggle also. So I hope you have understand about the tripartite circle. Tripartite struggle. Just tripartite struggle means the struggle in which three parties involved, and that is why it is called tripartite struggle. Why they wanted to get the control over Kannauj city? Because Kannauj city was located in the North India Upper Gangetic Valley, and it was rich in natural resources, and it has fertile land of Ganga, and it was the symbol of supremacy. So guys, here we have completed this topic. Okay, in this lesson we had learned about the Pals, the Rashtrakoots, after that the Gurjar Pratihars and tripartite struggle. And in our next lesson we are going to learn about the administration of the regional kingdoms. After that we have economy, and after that the Mahmud of Ghazni, then Muhammad Ghor, battle of Tarain. Then in that we are going to learn about the reasons of Prithviraj's defeat, the Chola kingdom, and after that Chola's administration. So up till that, I hope you will sit with your book, read the book carefully and highlight the important notes and make a note of it in your notebook. Till then, bye. We will meet in our next class.